Welcome to the professional talk by Dr. John Archer from King Abdullah University of Science and Technology, Saudi Arabia. Before we start, we would like to invite Dr. Rofandi bin Sulung to recite the dua. Please welcome.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إلى حضرتنا بالمصطفى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ثم إلى أرواح أزواجه وذرياته وأوليائه الصالحين شيء لله لهم الفاتحة أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين الحمد لله رب العالمين حمدا حامدين حمدا شاكرين حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكافئ مزيده يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك الكريم وعظيم سلطانك اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد في الأولين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد في الآخرين وصل وسلم على سيدنا محمد حتى ترث الأرض ومن عليها وأنت خير الوارثين اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا مما ينفعنا وزدنا علما اللهم افتح قلوبنا فتوح العارفين بحكمتك وانشر علينا من خزائن رحمتك وامنن علينا بالحفظ والفهم In conjunction with the professorial talk presented by Dr. John Archer this morning, O Allah, please bring us out of the darkness of doubt and favor us with the light of comprehension. O Allah, open to us the doors of your mercy and unfold us the treasures of your knowledge. O Allah, make useful for us what have you taught from knowledge that will be useful for us and for the community. O Allah, we ask you for beneficial knowledge and good deeds, strong memory, and perfect understanding. اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما. Ya Allah, jadikanlah perhimpunan kami pada pagi ini perhimpunan yang dirahmati Allah dan perpisahan kami selepas ini sebagai perpisahan yang diberkati Allah. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanah wa fil akhirati hasanah wa qina azabannar. Wa sallallahu wasallam ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Taqabbalallahu minkum.
Amin, amin ya rabbal alamin. Thank you, Dr. Rofandi Sulung, for the meaningful dua. May Allah bestow on our His grace and blessing. For not further delay, now we graciously invite Puan Nur Azah binti Muhammad Nawawi, Chief Director of Organizing Committee, to deliver opening remarks. Please welcome.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and good morning. Professor Dr. Muhammad Nur bin Nawawi, Vice Chancellor and Deputy Vice Chancellor, Administrative Planning and Global Engagement. Distinguished Speaker Dr. John Archer, Prof. Emeritus Datuk Dr. Abdul Latif bin Ibrahim, the Director of Institute of Bio-IT Selangor. Encik Samsul Azhar Muhammad Yusof, Registrar. Puan Zaitun binti Abdul Malik, Bursar of Unisel. Puan Hajah Fauziah binti Abdul Rahman, Head of Librarian and Head of Administrative of Vice Chancellor Office. Puan Rohani bin Zakaria, the Director Administration and Human Resources, the invited guests, deans and director of UNISEL, and ladies and gentlemen. Alhamdulillah, praise to Allah, with His bless, we are able to gather in this program. So may I take this opportunity to welcome to everyone here this morning, to our special guests, look around, see the smile of everyone's faces. We are truly delighted to welcome you today. We are pleased to have Dr. John Archer, who will give his talk on metabolic and synthetic engineering of marine microalgae factories. This special program is to mark the occasion on his appointment as adjunct professor at Institute of Bioethics Selangor Unisel. To Unisel management, especially to Prof Matno, thank you for coming to this event. And I can see many familiar faces, especially to Dr. Nur Azlin. What a companionable welcome. It's great to see you all here in this program, as many of you travel long distance and made a huge effort to come to join us today. So we are honored to have Dr. John Archer with us. He is a specialist in biotechnology field. He is one of the research collaborators of Institute of Bioethics Selangor since 2005. Today, Dr. John brings his passion and knowledge, so please be prepared to be challenged and inspired. And before I hand over to Mr. Nashrik, I want to say once more on behalf to the organizing committee, we are deeply appreciative and offer you our most grateful welcome. And please, and I would like to apologize for any inconvenience. To all the members of organizing committee, thank you for all the effort to materialize of this program. That's all. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's the moment that we have been waiting for. The ceremony humble call upon Professor Dr. Muhammad Nur bin Awawi, Vice President and Deputy Vice Chancellor, Administrative Planning and Global Engagement, to deliver his opening speech and thus officiating the ceremony. Please welcome.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. Wassalatu wassalamu ala asyrafil anbiya'i wal mursalin sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi washabbi ajmain. Our distinguished speaker, Dr. John Archer from King Abdullah University of Science and Technology, Professor Emeritus Dr. Abdul Latif bin Ibrahim, Director of Institute of Bioethics Selangor, Cik Samsul Azhar, our Registrar, Puan Zaitun, Bursar University, Puan Hajah Fauziah, Head of Library, Puan Rohani, Director of Administration and Human Resources, CEO invited guest, my dear friend Prof. Anwar, our former VC, Deans, Directors of Unisel, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure to welcome all of you to the inaugural professorial lecture on the occasion of the appointment of Dr. John Archer as adjunct professor. The appointment was actually bestowed to him last year during the international conference in November. In addition to the appointment, they also signed a letter of intent with Professor Abdul Latif, Director of BioIT, to develop a joint research project on biotechnology of microalgae for sustainable development. They have been actually started the project, as he is here with Dr. Nur Azlin. Welcome back, Nur Azlin. To assist BioIT research, to establish the microalgae lab and collection of samples. Dr. Azlin was formerly our senior lecturer at BioIT, for the information for some of you. What we'll see and hear this morning is part of the activities of Unisel strategy on impact and knowledge exchange to deliver knowledge and innovation for research excellence. Impact is the demonstrable contribution that excellent research, basic, uninspired and applied, makes to society and the economy. It embraces the diverse ways in which research-related knowledge and skills benefit individuals, organizations, and nations. Knowledge exchange is the two-way flow of people and ideas between the research environment and wider economy. thereby contributing to national prosperity, the quality of life of citizens, and cultural enrichment of our society. Knowledge transfer encompasses the systems and processes by which knowledge, expertise, and skilled people transfer between the research environment and its user communities in industry, commerce, public, and service sectors. Research-related impacts are derived through many mechanisms across university, including consultancy, collaborative or contract research, staff exchanges, licensing and spin-out company, formation, spin-out company formation, public engagement, and training and student enterprise. All of the different forms of knowledge exchange are embraced and included within this strategy. Unisel, in its efforts to increase its emphasis on KE, or knowledge exchange, will seek to develop a step change in the engagement of public policy and service providers, business and industry with Selangor government by facilitating the exploitation of research for economic and wider societal benefit at the university and state level. Mindful that strategy is ineffective without a clear view of how it will be implemented, this strategic mission is designed to guide the development of action plans at all levels within the university. It will provide toolkit to support researchers, institute and colleges in identifying, developing, and delivering impact from their research. Our philosophy is built around the following goals, where we want to build longer-term, mutually beneficial relationships with external partners. Support our partners to achieve success through contributions to the development of products and processes leading to economic, cultural, and societal benefits. Inform legislation, policy, and governmental guidelines for local, national, and international agendas. Promote cultural exchange within and between universities at local, national, and international levels. Improve the health and well-being of our communities and environment. Create career development opportunities for our students and academics. The aim of the strategy is to capitalize on the strength of our research portfolio and to accelerate generation of economic and societal impacts in the state of Selangor, Malaysia, and internationally through proactive knowledge exchange activities and relationships. The focus on two overarching themes when implemented across the university will help us achieve our defined aim. By implementing a holistic strategy, we will establish a university-wide framework for directing resource and activity, leading to knowledge exchange and external impacts with greater reach and significance. Overarching themes: A, environment and infrastructure. Create an environment where innovation, creativity, and enterprise flourish, and increase the number of staff and students engaging in knowledge exchange, commercialization, and public engagement. B, internationalization. To utilize our strong international-based knowledge exchange track record, for example, in developing and leading innovation centers, in the strategic development of our international partnerships, and to attract academic research business and other stakeholders to Selangor and Malaysia. Specific areas. Partnerships. Establish distinctive and user-focused approaches to university research user relationships that position as a partner choice for industry, cultural organizations, and public service providers. For the purpose of the discussion this morning, I will focus on internationalization. Internationalization is considered to be the process of integrating an international or intercultural dimension into our teaching, research, and service functions. Being an internationalized university is concerned with the development of a multicultural community of students and staff, the provision of supportive environment and educational experience that prepares our students for global political and social environments, and the development of international alliances and partnerships to support and build our capacity and capability in research, education, and enterprise. Unisel will focus on two of our core strategies: learning and teaching, and research and knowledge transfer. Already has at its heart the ambition of securing the university's international profile and standing with the top universities in the world. They, along with international student recruitment strategy, the human resources strategy, and the alumni development plan, represent considerable work in our progress. Our commitment to internationalization is evident in the university strategic plan for the next 3 years, beginning September 2016, when we launch our transformation agenda, Building in Excellence, which articulates our ambition to be one of the small number of universities recognized as being the best in the country, and the strategies that flow from it. In viewing internationalization over these perspectives, however, gaps are evident. While we have a range of international links and partnerships based on research and scholarship of our academics and on student exchanges, our approach to being an international university thus far has been serendipitous and somewhat fragmented. Our core strategies combine leave gaps on the one hand, i.e., example, partnership development, while producing unexploited overlaps on other issues. Issues which, when addressed, will improve the success and profile of the university. There are also barriers that have been identified by staff and students when considering the requirements of working on a wider canvas. Many of these are internal and to do with services and governance arrangements, such as our academic activity and educational ethics. Some barriers will be external and will involve the university effecting change through lobbying, policy making, and building influential relationships. Ladies and gentlemen, before I conclude my speech, I would like to congratulate Dr. John Archer for the academic feat of delivering his inaugural lecture today, and by so doing, discharging his academic obligation to Institute Biotechnology Selangor, BioIT Selangor, and Unisel, as well as ventilating to the world at large his major and invaluable contributions to science and technology. I want to close with a simple thank you, John, from the bottom of our hearts, for your spirit, for your vision, for your strength, and for your integrity, and for the position and for the passion for research and success that you have instilled to most of us. Once more, I warmly welcome you to this inaugural professorial lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, Yang Berbahagia Prof, for the very insightful and motivating speech. May we all benefit from the content of your speech. And the session will continue with the title Unisel as the Center of Excellence in the Life Science and Biotechnology of Rhodococcus for Sustainable Development. Please welcome.
Dr. John Archer from BioIT Selangor, because now he's an adjunct professor at our. And then I could see our great friends there, Professor Noor Mahadi, Emeritus Professor. Can you stand up, please? From Noor. Did he arrive? Is it? He's around? Yeah. He is one of those that are responsible for what we have here today. And colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I have met John for nearly a decade. And during that period, we have not established partnership, but friendship all the way. So it is most appropriate that we pay tribute to him for what he has done to us. But the problem is this, when I think about tributes, there are a lot of misunderstanding about it. At home, even at home, it begins at home, people said, who has passed away that you have to give a tribute? John Archer, I thought, is still alive. But I thought it's only in the at home, but even in the university, in my office. So for that, what do I do? The next one, please, sir. So I took a definition. A definition from the internet. So what we actually want to do this morning is this. A statement to show our gratitude, respect, and admiration for John Archer. That's what we are going to do today. Because John, you have done a lot for us, so it will always be remembered as Unisel move forward. So let me give you a little bit of background. How did this the partnership and friendship happen? Next slide, please. So in 2005, it's a very important occasion for Selangor at that time. So we thought 2005 will be our Vision 2020, which Malaysia was going for. But I'm not so sure it is so. So one of the things that I was asked by the Chief Minister of Selangor, he said, have an international conference. And I challenge you, you try to bring some of the top university to your conference. So of course, you talk about top university, well, it has to be in, if it is in UK, it has to be Cambridge, it has to be Oxford. If it's to be in America, there are many others, but I pick up the one that I know is MIT. So on that very day, on that, next one please, this is what we have. We have a program on partnership. That is, we have Professor Marion Dawkins from Oxford, she came, and we have John coming from Cambridge, and we have also Professor Sinsky from MIT, and the session is chaired by his wife and me. So it was certainly the university that the Chief Minister wanted to see. And he ends up, he said, arrange for me a breakfast with them. So remember, John, we have a breakfast with him in the morning to show that his appreciation for you. So our appreciation is to start 2005. Okay. The next one, please. This is Professor Marion Dawkins from Cambridge. Although she's not coming to talk about rhodococcus, but if we have something in common, the poultry. We work on the poultry, and so he came for that. That's what. Next one, please. And for John Archer, I asked Lynn to take him to the coast of Selangor, and then I went to some of the islands to see whether he would like to participate in the program that we are having. So where is this island? The next one, please. We have a small island. I think the Pulau Jemoh, where we thought it would become our marine lab as we progress. And this, the name Pulau Jemoh is very unique because there is another island named the same, but it's Indonesia. So one, I think from Nasir, yeah, I don't know, Nora said arranged for a seminar in Pekanbaru. The island is in Pekanbaru. So I had the opportunity to present our island there, but the people in Indonesia get confused. We thought that we have taken the island. It become a diplomatic thing. I was asked, why did you talk about that? I said, no, we have one in Sungai Buloh, next to Sungai Buloh. So it's quite a bit. The chief minister rang me up, and I did not talk about the island. We talked about our own. So that is how famous the island, John. So now, next one, please. This is the island. It's not like this now, but at one time when we were doing work with that, we have the lab, we have everything. It's a nice place to go to work and at the same time to have a rest. So what are we going to do with this island? Next one, please. We have a program, diversity. One of them is on microbes. One of them is on marine fish. One of them is on the mangrove. Of course, chicken and what is not part of the marine one, but because of my interest in them, so I would like to show you that they are also doing work in this area. So all the three projects were supported by the federal government, and among the three, the microbes seems to be progressing very well. So we thought that this should be our future direction in research. Next one, please. So this is exactly what the island is for, the concept of the island. But I will talk only to the third one. The third one is one of the main functions of the island is to be the field laboratory for the collection of microorganisms. That's why we should tell John, which to his interest is that this is what I like to. But he also liked the last function of the integrated R&D project. So with this exposure to John and that we are going to do a visit. Next one, please. This is, we brought John as part of our team. Okay, part of our team. But the next one is, where are we going to get the money? Well, we are going to approach Prof. And we have a discussion one night. If you can remember, John, the one at the restaurant, we talked. So what did we propose to No? Next one, please. We have a collection. We have a lot of microbes that we isolated across the state of Selangor and also at Pulau Jemo. So one of the microbes here we thought will be suitable for the research. Next one, please. So we thought it's Rhodococcus. I will not elaborate the Rhodococcus here, but I think John will mention it afterward. I'm very sure of it. He'll mention a little of it. But one of the things that we are interested is Rhodococcus is equipped a large number of enzymatic activities, unique cell walls, and unique cells. So we want enzyme. If you want to go for commercialization, you go for enzyme. So we go for Rhodococcus. Next one, please. Tuka, why do you want to do Rhodococcus? So we have a discussion. We say that we will start because we are weak in our genomics, bioinformatics, and proteomics, and this could be a good tool to learn from Cambridge. And of course, Rhodococcus is very important also in Europe. However, looking at the title, Directed Molecular Evolution of Genus Rhodococcus for Industrial Enzyme Synthesis, it will not please our administrative boss. They don't like it. I don't think they don't want to hear. So I have taken the opportunity to change a little bit, put at that green chemistry and industrial biotechnology. I think this is what we propose to Emeritus Professor Mano, and then he was approved. The next one, please. So the approach in our discussion is build up an international interdisciplinary teams of research groups working on a shared version. So that's what So these are some of the works I think that we have to do. I will not elaborate it. But the last one is the one that we want to have it. Development genome to enzyme informatic pipeline for platform strain with genetic application and other systems. The next one, please. So this is the group that we have lined up. So it's quite a big group. So we have one, the local one. This is give you a very unique team of people. So from Malaysia itself, you have UKM, UPM, and of course, the sponsor, MGI. Then we have the international, University of Cambridge. At that time, we have University of Hokkaido also as part of it. But it falls off because I think there is a little bit of difference in the procedure for working in a lab. And of course, we have an industry, and these are the team. You see there, that's for Professor Sinsky, and Professor Rao, and me. Then we have the full team there. We have John, we have there, me, and Pro Mino, and also our colleagues from Japan, and the rest of them. And we have another one, a group that is part of our team is Imperial College. Professor Tony Kass is there, he's been coming here off and on. Tony Kass has been our partner for a long time because four of our staff got their PhD from, two from Imperial, two as a co-supervisor, that is for Freddy and for Magala, the co-supervisor. The next one, please. Okay, this is what we mentioned by you, the pipeline for enzyme. So to do this, you need the place, you need the microbiology. You collect the microbes that you want, Rhodococcus. You do the genomics, that is where John is, the specialist on that, that will learn us. So since we are not very familiar with this, so we managed to get scholarship and ask Lynn to go to Cambridge under John Archer. So Lynn was the first pioneers in this project. Then we have to know a little bit about bioinformatics. Well, we don't have any. So, but it's not too late. I think Yang Ti has taken the challenge to work on bioinformatics. And of course, the pipeline consists of the enzyme. The enzyme is a protein, which I think Yang Ti will have, of course. Engineering has always been part of us. We have always a problem in engineering, but we managed to bring Dr. Salina to be part of our team now. He is supposed to be giving us the enzymes and for commercialization. And of course, these are the pipeline that we are mentioning about. So you can see it. It's not an easy, you need to bring everybody who are familiar with it. But my gratitude to John is this. We have all these people here now. They are ready to do it, except for one more that we are not able to do it, I will tell you. Next one, please. This is the objective. We wanted to do the last one too. That is the cell biofactory. We thought that we could work it with the our Japanese team, but unfortunately, there are barriers at the same time. John left Cambridge for the green pasture. And not only he took Lynn with him, Lynn is supposed to help us, yeah? He took Lynn. He took even my research assistant, Jaja, to leaving us all. So that's why he's paying back now, you know? He has to pay back. We bring Lynn. Okay, next one, please. Okay, the project objective is the same thing again, as I said to you. We want a unique strain of Rhodococcus that will give us the necessary enzyme that can be used for industrial biocatalyst. The next one, please. Cool. This is the flow of the project. Again, we progemo, then microbiology, then we have genomics, then we have bioinformatics, we have the proteomics. Then we have done the proof of concept, because you need to do the proof of concept that yes, you can produce enzyme, it is quite before you do upscaling. We were supposed to do the upscaling, but things we don't know what happened. We were stalled for a while, and it's manufacturing. But one of the things that I like about this project is this: it helps me to tell my staff and also student what STEM is all about. This is a STEM. For you are all student, you are kita selalu cakap STEM kan? Inilah dia the project. So we are, when we talk to you about STEM, we are talking on the thing that we have done, not because we read it. So the sign is in the beginning there, S plus M. Then you go a bit down the T. T plus M, the technology. Then you go down, you can see the factories and all thing engine. That is where the engineering is. And of course, is the M. The M is supposed to be mathematics. It's part of everybody. You do science, you want mathematics. You do technology, you want mathematics. You do engineering, you want mathematics. You have to build a factory. But to make it more important, the maths that I put here also makes money. And you want to be down, be millionaire. So that makes the student a little bit more interested in STEM. Okay, the next one, please. This is the team. We have two teams. One from Cambridge. This is John, Zlin there, Azar, Atia. These are all the people in the molecular biologists, right? And our friend Abdullah was supposed to be part of it, but he ran away to do his PhD somewhere else. Okay, now let's look at another one. Next one, please. This is the Imperial team. Two did their PhD here, Mangala and Freddy. That is Freddy, that's Mangala. And that's we have there is this Julius Nagy, Dr. Julius Nagy. And he was quite a popular one because we have star people coming to take this work. This appeared in the paper. So this is how we operate it, and all this thing is through the efforts of John. So next one, please, if you don't take that. This is the thing that we want to do. It's so simple. Yeah. It is the radio caucus. What we want is there are stand heat. That's the one that we want it to be. Diverse metabolism, but more important, they are quite tolerant to some of the toxic material. That's why it is very good for bioremediation and green chemistry. Okay, the next one, please. This is the one that being analyzed by John and Lin, and we were the first in the analysis of radiococcal present in Peninsula of Malaysia. So with that, I think we should have the honor of being a center of excellence. Okay, and there is a significant sequence evidence to support the emergence of 9 more. So we have more than 20. We have about 20. All these things. So I think this has brought us to a stage that we are able to be calling ourselves as a center of excellence in radiococcus. But to support what we say, the next one, please. This is the one that we could not get it. But without that also, we are enough to be a champion of radiococcus because this is what we are supposed to do. But I think John will introduce to us another one today that we shall still work on, the biofactory. But I was excited about it. Next one, please. Based on this, you can even produce virus. I'm a virologist. If I can produce virus from that, then it's good for my vaccine production. So I think we have done a lot more than what we should be doing enough during that period. But John will teach us. With microalgae, with Azar will be responsible for it. With all our engineers and all. This is the team that I draw. That's why we need the engineers, we need the technologies, and we also need the mathematician. Next one, please. This tells you that one day I received a letter from Mr. Noh saying that you are now the satellite laboratory program of MGI. So I think that is enough to confirm our excellence. So for this, John, we would like to thank you very much for everything. And the next one, please. This is the next one. This is our appreciation for you. If you look at anyone there, the other side, that's where they went to Cambridge. Haza, you know, went to Cambridge to go for training. And the next one is, no, not check. Not check. The next one below that is where you collect. You remember you want to throw one of the, my stuff into the water to collect? No, because you cannot get it, he wants to throw him. Then we had a team, and we have the ladies there. I put the ladies, those are the 10 ladies that been helping me throughout. But there are only 80% functional, because the other 20%, they get pregnant. But they give me a lot of grandchildren. That's good enough for me. Okay, the next one is the team that I show you just now. And the one with Judith. And that's my, no, Prof, my chairing the team, or the whole team. He do it once a year. And John is there, and all of us there. But of course, on the top, on the right there, I probably did not bring my, that's the meeting we have, the two teams meeting in Cambridge. That is Tony Cass there. There, that's the, on the left there, and that's John there. So we have a meeting in Cambridge. So it is a very well coordinated program, which I think we should not throw it away. And in fact, we should, this progress that we made in the last annual international conference, and we present it. So I will be inviting Magala to say a few words on what we have done. Then I think this is all that I have. My celebrity also. Well, there's one person that, not this, I think. This is, I want to tell you, when I was reading, I came across this. I could not believe when he said that, don't read success story, you will only get message. I don't know whether it is true or not. But then he said, read failure stories and you will get some ideas to great success. At the time, I don't believe, I think he might be crazy. But now I think I believe him. Why? Maybe Donald Trump follow his words and become a president of, he follow the exercise. So is there any more? Okay, thank you. Me to try. I think there's one more. Can you? Bawa. Like that too. This is, I want to, I think, Radio Caucus will not be complete. We don't also pay respect to Judith Nagy, see the Malaysian now. When she, every time she comes here, just like John. John comes here to get his nasi lemak and his teh tarik, she also followed it. That's Dr. Judith Nagy. But unfortunately, on the 3rd of October, he passed away. We lost him very much because he has been helping. He was the co-supervisor for Magala. And so what happened to her that night? Next one, please. This is what happened. She had a small car, I think. I never thought it could happen in UK. But this is, so let me conclude my presentation, your talk today. Our the contribution that has been made by Dr. John Archer and also Dr. Judy Nagy for what we are here now. We can be proud to say that we are now the center of Thailand in biotechnology of Rhodococcus, all the whole, that is Unisel has become that partner. We will work with anybody that are interested in this. So thank you once again, John, for all your efforts. And we hope that you will continue with our microalgae. We will be hearing from you soon. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pradatif. A very good morning to all. It is indeed an honor to be addressing such an esteemed crowd. I would also like to thank the organizing committee for giving me this opportunity to share our success story in the organization of our International Conference on Life Sciences Revolution, ICLSR 2015, with the theme, Harnessing the Power of Microbes through convergence of life sciences. This conference provided us a platform to discuss the way forward in life sciences research, focusing on our own local natural asset, which is the bacteria rhodococcus. Next slide, please. Okay. I would like to proceed further with my presentation by introducing the project which prompted the organization of ICLSR 2015. The project entitled Building of Genomics-Led Green Chemistry for Industrial Biotechnology was a brilliant idea given by none other than our guest of honor, Dr. John Archer, together with Prof. Latif. They realized that rhodococcus has a huge potential to be exploited as in the bioremediation of toxic compounds found in the environment. As anticipated, this mega project discovered many enzymes produced by rhodococcus to degrade toxic compounds liberated from the industries such as cyanide, nitrile, and phenol. Next slide, please. As such, an idea to organize an international conference was initiated so that we could share our knowledge and research findings with the scientific community. So we were very thankful because the idea was fully supported by University Selangor and generously funded by the Selangor State Government. Next slide, please. So these are some of the objectives of the conference. In a nutshell, the conference promoted research in life sciences convergence and emphasized on STEM education to build knowledge, society, and economy. Next slide, please. Okay, this is the main highlight of the conference, whereby we had a special session on rhodococcus to showcase the research on rhodococcus in green chemistry. As you can see here, the session accommodated five oral speakers and was chaired by Dr. Archer himself. Overall, we had 19 slots for oral presentation, and we published 54 proceedings which were presented as poster exhibitions during the conference. Next slide, please. So these are some of the pictures that we gathered during the conference. So you can see Dr. Archer is there, always supporting our program. Next slide. Again, Dr. Archer and Prof. Sinski. Next slide. Okay, one of the major achievements of International Conference on Life Sciences Revolution is the recognition of Institute of Bio-IT's lab as the satellite lab by Genome Malaysia. Secondly, we managed to bring together three institutes, namely Genome Malaysia, iFarm, and also ABI, so that they could share with us their latest research finding. And thirdly, a spin-off seminar on women's health was organized subsequently. Next slide, please. These are some of the suggestions that we gathered post-conference. It has been suggested that Unisel should move from proof of concept-based experiments to upscaling and ultimately work towards commercialization. Next slide, please. Human resource development is the biggest strength of the mega project Rhodococcus, as you can see from the statistics here. We have the project produced 8 PhD graduates, 2 in the making, and 5 master graduates, 1 in the making, respectively. In terms of publication, we have recently published a chapter in a book, and in addition to that, we have 28 publications in indexed journals and 49 publications in proceedings. Next slide, please. Okay. So this is the chapter that we have actually produced. The title of the chapter is Rhodococcus UKMP5M, a versatile bioremediation microorganism, which was published in Biodegradation, Properties, Analysis, and Performance. Next slide, please. And besides human, and finally, besides human resource development, we have also secured industrial linkages through this project with Hartalega, a glove company located at Bestari Jaya. We collected their wastewater, which contained nitrile, and and it was subjected to bioremediation using rhodococcus, which was proven successful. Next slide, please. So basically, that was the summary of the international conference and rhodococcus project. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a 5-minute break to allow the preparation for the next session.
John Archer, current position, University King Abdullah University of Science and Technology, Computational Bioscience Research Center, Head Data Generation, Validation and Engineering, Education, BSc Honours, University of Essex, PhD, University of Glasgow, Postdoctoral Training, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, Professional, University of Cambridge, Department of Genetics, 1992-2009. University of Umeå, Sweden, 1999-2009 as visiting professor. King Abdullah University of Science and Technology, KAUST, 2009 to present. Unisel Bio-IT, Unisel Bio-IT, Malaysia Adjunct Professor, 2016 to present. John Archer was born and grew up in the county of Kent. Oh, I was there before. Which is the southernmost county in England and the closest to France. They call it Garden of England, isn't it? Yeah. His family hails from England, Ireland, and France, reflecting historical movements across the British Isles. Indeed, his family name is an old Norman French name that came to England over 1,000 years ago. After gaining his Bachelor's Honours in Biological Sciences in the University of Essex in 1982, John moved to Scotland, to the University of Glasgow, where he joined Professor Sharati's laboratory studying E. coli plasmid function. In his PhD research, John set up Sanger DDOC DNA sequencing in his department and started his long-term interest in genomics and bioinformatics. In Scotland, John, who was a keen saber fencer, captained the Scottish University saber team and fenced against England under the Scottish flag. What an irony. On completion of his PhD in 1986, John moved again to USA to join Professor Anthony Sinsky's laboratory in the Department of Biology, MIT, for his doctoral training. He spent 6 years at MIT working on metabolic engineering of high-efficiency lithionine. Find it very difficult for me to pronounce. In addition to publishing multiple high-level research papers, John also developed a deregulated homoserine dehydrogenase enzyme, which is the key bottleneck in L-theanine. Is the pronunciation correct? This technology was licensed to the food conglomerate ADM, where it plays a key role in the production, in the annual production of over 2,100 tons of L-theanine. In 1991, John joined the University of Cambridge, Department of Genetics, where his research focused on genetics and genomics of non-model mycotic acid bacteria Rhodococcus, isn't it? This was the basis of the first green chemistry collaboration between Cambridge and Unisel, which continues to this day. In 2007, he was approached by the Saudi government to assist in designing the biological engineering division at the King Abdullah University of Science and Technology. In 2008, he was appointed director of the Cambridge Cows Academic Partnership, a $25 million USD research of program of research and capacity building. In 2009, he joined Cows with an appointment in the Office of the President and the Occupational Bioscience Research Center. At Cows, he heads data generation, validation, and engineering research group. John believes firmly that universities have a duty to develop and grow new technologies and industries in addition to their traditional role in teaching, scholarship, and research. He has recently founded the first biotechnology company in Saudi Arabia. He has published over 70 academic papers and 18 patents and founded 3 biotechnology companies. John, thank you.
Vice Chancellor, Emeritus Professors, Professors, friends, members of the university, members of our university, good morning, salam alaikum, salamat pagi. It is a fantastic honor to be here today. I do not deserve the recognition that I appear to be given by my friends. Remember, your friends always say nice things about you. I'm quite normal, and we have a lot of work to do. The work has only just started. So today I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what we have done, a little more about what we are doing now, and a small part about what we are doing in the future together. And afterwards, for the young scientists in the room, who I hope will become one day successful scientists and even successful entrepreneurs, I'm happy to chit-chat and so on. And we're here for some time through the week. We're still working on, and we'll be back from time to time. So if we can have the first slide. My talk is, the title, Metabolic Engineering, Synthetic Engineering of Marine Microalgae Cell Factories. You already have heard about a cell factory. It is a microbe that has been engineered to, It's been engineered to act as a producer of biological molecules. In the Rhodococcus project, which we brought to a very high level, we were using organisms that took carbon in from the outside as food and grew and then converted that carbon into various molecules, some of which we're interested in. In the case of Saudi Arabia, there is no sugar. Khalas, there's no sugar. All the sugar comes from Egypt, from other places. The only thing they have is oil, bless them. You can't therefore build a biological based industry that requires to import everything. You need to use something else. And that's why we've opted for photosynthetic cell factories. But the real key is it's green chemistry, either heterotrophic green chemistry or photosynthetic green chemistry. Next slide, please. So I will just review very briefly the successful work that we've done. And when, for you young scientists, when you start a collaboration, it's about trust. It's a human interaction. We're very human scientists. It's about friendship. It's about shared experience. And it's about doing the work. Next slide, please. So here you see us really are just reviewing in 4 pictures the output from the Rhodococcus project Unisel Cambridge were running. And indeed, it went into KAUST because, as Prof. Latif mentioned, I jumped ship off to Saudi just towards the end. It was an investigation into carbon storage metabolism in Cambridge, for which an entire group of new industrial potential microbes were isolated by Noor Azlin here. And you can see us at the beginning. This is Kimi, okay? And we wanted to get samples from the middle of the poem Lagoon. We couldn't get a pole long enough, so I suggested Kimi jump in. But then he informed me that the lagoon was about 80 degrees centigrade, so we decided not to. I wasn't going to throw him in at any stage. I was trying to encourage him to swim in. But we did get a big pole and we took samples, and from those we isolated strains. This work led to tangible results in terms of science, also in terms of capacity building. We had Azza and, is that Yanti? That's Yanti, yeah? Yeah, Azza and Yanti came over to Cambridge for training. Yanti is now a fully fledged bioinformatician, and Azza has just got her PhD. And then Azlin is wearing the very warm and comfortable Cambridge gown. That's her when she graduated in 2012. So this program succeeded in producing many of its outputs, and it left one that very few collaborative programs have ever done, the desire on both sides to continue the work, even if there is no money. So we did, okay? So we've somehow kept things going, and this project is a great success. Next slide, please. We've started a new project here at Unisel, and this is a project really following on from the Rhodococcus and adding to it, in as much as we're looking at microalgae from Malaysia as potential green chemistry, sustainable, carbon neutral biocatalysts. And that will also have research placements and PhD studentships within it. The pictures you see here are a foray to a hot spring. Hot springs are very interesting because they are, from an ecological perspective, an island. The water is sulfurous, salty, very hot. The surrounding area is forest, whatever. It's not covered in sulfur and it's certainly not as hot. So this is an independent island, and it has actually got quite different environmental driven evolution. So you get quite different organisms there. And we brought the organisms back. We went sampling last week, and this is the team in the lab. There's Mira, there's Azza, there's Azlin, and then there's this fat Matsali at the beginning there. And it's just started, but we have already got some results. Next slide, please. Here you can see two oscillatorian cells that we are targeting in our work. We don't know what they do yet. They're the first few that we found. We will continue to work on this. But what we want to do is produce a library of industrial bacteria that are photosynthetic, so they take carbon in, all right? So we'll talk more about that later. Okay, next slide, please. So we now are moving into the work we're doing at KAUST, and it's really driven by a deep and pressing concern, which is climate change. Next slide, please. Here you can see the Keeling curve. This large curve is a measure of atmospheric CO2, started in 1957 by a PhD student called Keeling. He measured CO2 content and he kept doing it. And what you see is the CO2 content goes up in the winter, down in the summer. That was what he was wanting to study, because it goes down in the summer because the plants are photosynthesizing. This is in the northern hemisphere. It's not lovely Malaysia where you have constant light, constant growth. In the winter, we all go gray and dark and nothing much happens. And the surprising thing was, through the time of his PhD, he measured substantial rises in CO2. That has now been carrying on, and it's now over 400 parts per million. If you look at the inset graph, and I'm sorry the scale is not shown so well, that inset graph is from geological data gleaned from ice cores in the Antarctic, where they measure huge ice cores going down into the depths of the Antarctic, going back in time. And you can see that the world has gone through a 100,000-year oscillation in CO2 content that runs roughly between 200 and 250 parts per million. Now we're at 400 parts per million. And the point about this, 21% increase in the last 48 years, is that the rate of CO2 sequestration by geological processes, chemical processes, biological processes, green plants, marine algae in the sea, it's no longer keeping up with the CO2 that we're pumping out. What is that doing? Next slide, please. What that's doing, we can tell. From 1880 to 2012, this is a set of data, ships in the British Navy have been making measurements of sea surface temperature as a routine element of their work since that time. And that data, other navies have followed it. It's part of the standard operating procedure in marine, maritime organizations. They just have done it. It's a practice. The result is that we have tremendous data set going back over 100 years. And what that shows is the long-term trend is between half, shall we say, and 1 degree centigrade rise in the surface temperature. The sea level, again, remembering that maritime people are interested in where the sea is and where the rocks are, they know exactly the height of water. They see now sea level has gone up between 0.1 and 0.2 of a meter. There's a 26% increase in the acidity of the sea. These are all very, very critical, dangerous events. What they're saying is our world is unable to homeostatically control CO2 levels, and that has changed the temperature profile of the world, and that has changed the height of water around the world. These are massive changes, and they are extremely concerning. They will affect the way we all live. Next slide, please. So realizing that, the United Nations has led the charge with the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change. In the early stages, they were working to see, was there climate change? And now, with the exception of one or two perhaps not so well-informed people, most scientists are quite convinced that the data is consistent with the hypothesis that climate change is happening. As a result, the Paris Agreement has been put out and has been signed by the largest polluters on the planet, and many others are joining now. About 120 countries have joined, and that locks countries in to changing the way they operate to reduce the temperature rise. So they're not aiming at CO2, they're just saying, whatever you do, get the temperature down. And the whole point is, as Ban Ki-moon said himself, the era of consumption without consequence is over. We must decarbonize our economies. We're going to have to change the way we operate. Next slide, please. So in order to achieve, even with the most conservative models for climate change, to maintain a 2 degree rise, now remembering we've already done 1 degree, okay? So we've really got 1 degree to play with, we have to cap CO2. Now what that means, we have very well established fossil fuel reserve measurement techniques. All of the oil companies, Petronas, Saudi Aramco, etc., etc., they measure how much oil they have, how much oil they know they can get out of the ground. And you can look at that data, it's published. It's published by the International Energy Authority. And if you take that data and convert it into, basically you combust it, the CO2 produced will massively outweigh this 1 degree limit. What that means is that the reserves are going to remain in the ground. Now, His Excellency Minister of Petroleum in Saudi Arabia, Sheikh Amani, said way back in the 80s, the Stone Age did not end because we ran out of stone. It's going to change. His Excellency Khaled Al-Falah, Minister of Petroleum and Energy in Saudi Arabia now, has said in 15 years' time, oil will be one of the energy options available. It will probably be there for ships and for aircraft. But whether it's there, petroleum-based oil going into your car is another question. So even Saudi is looking at a diversified economy. If you want to remove petrochemicals, you need to have a substitution. You're sitting on petrochemicals. I'm wearing petrochemicals, apart from this shirt from John Masters is made of bamboo fiber, which is an example of Malaysian ingenuity in making a sustainable, perfectly reasonable material from biological source. So we need alternatives. And it turns out that photosynthetic microbes can, in fact, produce some of the molecules that we're going to need. But in order to do that, they have to be made much more efficient. Next slide, please. So the group that we're going to look at are the cyanobacteria. And for those of you who have never met them before, they've been here a while, 3.2 billion years ago. Cyanobacteria are responsible for the biggest pollution event on this Earth. They put oxygen into the atmosphere and completely changed the world from a reduced to an oxygen-containing atmosphere. They're the origin of green plants. They're unicellular or multicellular, and they have really tremendous capabilities that we're going to look at in the next slide. So here you see all of these are ones that we've isolated in Saudi. You have very simple cells that look like E. coli, grow like E. coli, only they grow on sunlight. You have others that have a second division perpendicular to the other, so they form little hot cross buns. Then you have others that form filaments. Then you form more elaborate filaments, and then you form effectively cathedrals of filaments. Okay, so this is a group of bacteria that have got development, they've got complex genetics. Moreover, you can find evidence in fossil records from 2.8 billion years ago that the same type of filamentous organisms still exist today. So the body plan, let alone the genes, but the body plan remains the same. So this is a highly successful group. Next slide, please. The way it operates and the way to understand photosynthesis is really rather simple. In order to polymerize carbon, you need a lot of energy. Okay? It's basically like being kaya. If you're rich, you can pretty much do whatever you like, right? You just pay someone and eventually it will happen. So if you have a very high level of chemical energy that you can obtain, you can spend that energy sticking CO2 together. So photosynthesis consists of two activities, the so-called light reaction, which fundamentally generates NADPH and ATP, and by the way, puts out oxygen, right? And this happens inside the cell. Here you have one of our cells, CCF101, and we're showing an electron microscope slide of the inside of the cell. You can see the thylakoid membrane, and the thylakoid membrane is shown in the diagram there, and I won't go through it, but we can go later. Photosystem 1, photosystem 2. Everyone remember that stuff, right? So the whole point is you use a bag, you take those hydrogens, you put the hydrogens in a bag, and then you let them run through ATPase, which is a water wheel, effectively, which makes ATP. You also have on the other photosystem, you're making NADPH. So you make ATP and NADPH. Next slide, please. Following that, you now have a great big bag of money. You can do what you like. So you go to the carboxysome, and there with Rubisco, you actually polymerize carbon. And so that's how that all works. That is CO2 being taken in and converted to metabolically useful products. Let's move on, please. What that then leads to is this very simple diagram. On the left, the Calvin cycle is generating 3PG. That then goes through phosphoenolpyruvate, pyruvate, and from there feeds into the TCA as well as the rest of the cell, okay? So you have effectively a very quick way to get carbon into the metabolism. Next slide, please. From there, it elaborates into whatever metabolic products the cell needs or whatever metabolic products you engineer the cell to make. So you have a whole series of molecules that can be made. And here's just a few examples that can come out of cyanobacterial factories. Next slide, please. Okay. Why do it in deserts? There are better places to live, you know? There's no water in a desert. We know that sequestration is now being outstripped by production. We know that photosynthesis can actually fix carbon. We know photosynthesis across the world fixes a massive amount of carbon. So the rates and the flux are pretty good. However, if you want to increase biological carbon capture, anywhere that's green or blue is already doing it. You can't get much more out of it. You have to go to somewhere brown, the deserts. Okay, next slide, please. The deserts are the only available land that is available for us to do biological carbon capture. What we don't want to do is set up a technology that starts to compete with food production. Because what will happen is we'll be okay, you know, we're all pretty rich. But if you're poor, farms will stop making food and they'll start making bioproducts and the crust of food will go up. So you want to really do this technology carefully in areas where you are not going to compete with existing land use. Next slide, please. So algal biotechnology in Saudi Arabia. Saudi is a beautiful country. Over the years I've been there, I've come to love the people. They are funny, they are in an interesting situation in their country. They take that well. They believe pretty much. Some of them are a little naughty, but you know, most of them are rather nice. And here is the Red Sea coast. This is like Langkawi. It's beautiful, isn't it? Except there's no green behind. It's just desert. Okay? But that is the typical coastline of Saudi Arabia. Next slide, please. Saudi Arabia, as you know, is the number one producer of oil on the planet. They have about 40 to 50% of the world's oil reserves. They produce 12 million barrels of oil a day, which is a massive amount. It's about 40% of global production. They're the only country that can raise and lower production rapidly because they have very, very well-built and advanced oil production systems. As a result, they make the market. Following on from that, they're the number seven in the world of CO2 producers. They produce 610 million tons in 2014. That is a massive amount of CO2. Moreover, it's coming from about 28 independent, coastal located, ginormous factories. Okay? So you have point source CO2 on the coast in Saudi Arabia. Next slide, please. When you look at Saudi Arabia, if you're going to do photosynthesis, you need sunlight. That's your free energy. That's how you are kaya. That's how you can spend chemical energy freely. The sunlight in Saudi Arabia is very, very high. Although you are more southern, you have a monsoon climate, you have clouds, you have weather, you have rain clouds. Saudi Arabia, if we see a cloud, we will run outside and look at it because we've never seen one before. It's just blue. Okay. Occasionally it rains in Riyadh, but that's because that's the people of Riyadh deserve it. And they get cold. In Jeddah, it's lovely all the time. No rain, hardly. Okay. When we look at the temperature, this is data we've taken in the lab. We actually have a reasonable temperature range that the most we get to is about 45. Okay. Another nice thing about it is you have a 12-hour day. 12-hour night, plus or minus 15 minutes. This has tremendous advantages for Ramadan. It's easier to do Ramadan in Saudi than perhaps in northern areas. It's also a tremendous opportunity if you're running a company. Imagine if you were running a business where in the winter time, people worked 3 hours, and in the summertime, they worked 18. Okay, it's unsustainable. 12-12 works perfectly for us to have cells working as factories. the amount of light we get is 22 microeinsteins, which is a measurement of photons, okay? So you measure the flux of photons, 2200. The most the world gets is 2400, okay? So this is pretty much near the top end of what you could expect. Next slide, please. So when you think about having a technology, and this is part of what I do, I think about science and I think about research a lot, but I also think, if I was going to spin this out and make a new technology, would this technology fit where we are? Okay, more of that later, but you can see that Saudi Arabia has got very long coastlines. The land is incredibly flat. It's not like a big bukit is a hill, right? I forget what a mountain is, a big bukit. There are no bukits. The bukits are in the middle. It's basically a flat beach, and the sea has dropped away from it, so it's very flat. You need flat land for this sort of work. You also need it next to the sea, because fresh water is very expensive, because it's made by boiling seawater, okay? We filled a Chevrolet Suburban, which is the car the American president drives in, and a small car behind, for the price of two cups of Starbucks coffee, which tells you that in Saudi Arabia, either petrol is too cheap or Starbucks coffee too expensive. I leave you to make the decision. But you cannot use fresh water. It's got to be marine water, okay? So techno-economic analyses carried out by economists have shown that Saudi is the number one area for this sort of work in the world. So, okay, let's go and do it. Next slide. We have the sun. We have land, we have water, we have CO2. Oh dear, we don't have strains. All the strains in the strain libraries were isolated in higher latitudes, typically Europe, Northern America, and there I am a matsale. I am what grows well up there, okay? I can make vitamin D in very low sunlight. Put me out here, I go red, burn, and get cancer, okay? It's just the way things are. Now, we don't have any strains. Basically, all the strains the people were using were Matsali strains, and what we want is some Saudi strains. So we're going to move. Next slide, please. So we started isolating strains from the Red Sea. There's the Red Sea there. It's an interesting baby ocean. It's our youngest ocean, and it's like your hands cupped. There's a shallow sill at the front, where you have entrance into the Indian Ocean, and then water trapped inside. There's no river flow, nothing. It's basically surrounded by desert, and it's like a saucepan. It boils the water off, and the water is very, very salty. We measure the water salinity using something called a practical salinity unit. This is the standard hydrogeographica's way of doing it, and it doesn't refer to molarity. It measures total electrolyte, all right? Now, the Pacific is 30, just 30. Fresh water is zero. You can drink up to 10. So like if you had some of these healthy drinking waters, they're a bit salty, that'd be about 10. But 30 is what you see in a typical ocean. Saudi Arabia is 40. Dead Sea is about 60, okay? So that gives you an idea of scale. Now, we will start looking there for our source of cyanobacteria. And here are some pictures of the team. There is Jaja, who I stole from Unisel, and Aslin, who I stole from Unisel. I was like a Malaccan pirate. I took them off. And what we're doing is a bioprospecting program up and down the Western Shore. Next slide, please. The things that we're looking for, you must be able to stand the sunlight between 1600 and 2200. You must be able to, thank you so much, God bless you. I can go for another 2 hours now. temperature, you have to have high temperature, and you must be able to deal with high salt. The salt is a big question. Imagine, if you will, you're growing algae in some kind of industrial situation. You're blowing air and CO2 into the algae. That's how you get them to grow fast. Okay? The result of that is large-scale evaporation. If you had an open pond, it will lose 20% of its volume a day, which means you will either have to be filling the pond with fresh water, which that fresh water should be for babies, mothers, you know, people. You shouldn't be feeding microalgae with it. You need to have microalgae that can withstand a high salinity above the salinity of the water they were in. Because as you grow, after the first day, it's going to be more salty. The third day more salty, the fourth day more salty. The way we operate is in batch mode, and typically you won't go very much beyond 10 days. Okay? And so you can mitigate the rise by adding seawater. Okay? But still the salt will go up. So salt is a major problem. Okay, next slide. Here is our fleet. Doesn't it look lovely? We did most of our work on Explorer 1. Explorer 1 is like our favorite boat. She's getting a little old now, and sometimes her two engines, one might not work. Sometimes the winch might not work, but she's a beautiful old boat, and we've gone out loads of times in that. Here is the RV Thual. This is like an aircraft carrier, and we use that for long distance runs. That is an incredible machine. And then we have the Kaust 1. I draw your attention to the two 250 horsepower outboard motors. I asked the captain, why does it have two? And he said, I'm sorry, we couldn't get three. So Saudis, they have one way with a boat. You push the throttle as far forward as you can and hold on. So that will do 39 knots, which is like a military assault boat. And we go out on that at our peril. So we use these for three different sorts of sampling, long distance far sampling, middle distance, and then close inshore. Next slide, please. The way we do the sampling is we use these rosettes. This is the big boy's version of a bucket, basically. What you have is tubes with sprung-loaded doors. You drop it down, and at specific preset depth, the doors shut, and you now have water from that depth. So you can take water from any number of depths independently. It also has a chemical sensor mode, and so you can get chemical sensor data. So we have either 12 by 10 liter or 110 liter shot line, depending on the boat, and we get data on the salinity and temperature and depth from the data set. Next slide, please. So here we go out. Here's RV Thual. The guys in the blue uniforms are the highly trained deck sailors. This rosette weighs about a metric ton, and when it's on the boat, it starts swinging around. It could swing from here to the fan, and if it hit you, well, you'd be very seriously injured. So we're in the orange suits, made most famous by Guantanamo Bay, but honestly, we didn't leave there. The orange suits are us, scientists, crew, and then blue suits are the marine guys, and we take samples and process them on the boat. So the way we do it is we take depth samples 2, 10, 20, 50, and screen through filters, use those filters to inoculate 30 mil culture, place that culture in different conditions. Cultures can be different conditions, so we have a selection regime. Next slide, please. Inside the lab, there's Eslin, we have what you call uni-algal cultures. So you purify a microalgae until it is just one microalgus in there, okay? Microalga in there. So that's uni-algal. And we look for their CO2 tolerance, their light, salinity, and temperature profile. So this is a bit like sort of giving you a benchmark on the strains, okay? Next slide, please. Once we've got that, we take the best strains, that is strains that grow at high temperature, high salinity, and grow fast. We're looking for fast growth because fast growth means high carbon flux, which means the cell can process carbon rapidly through its metabolism. That is a co-adapted trait. You can't get that trait by changing one gene, two genes. It's a complete metabolism-wide trait, and therefore it's easier to get it in the first place, select for a fast-growing organism. When we've got the key strains that we want, we then carry out in the lab DNA sequencing, and Professor Noor will be looking and recognizing all of these machines. So this is Nisa from Kuala Lumpur, who is happy showing her strains. There's Yime, again from Kuala Lumpur, and I think Jaja from Pahang. Anyway, it's a pretty Malaysian group I've got. DNA sequence is carried out. We use MySeq, then HiSeq, then PacBio, and then we use a supercomputer to do the assemblies. Next slide, please. The assemblies, I tend to do those because they say I'm getting too old to be in the lab. I don't know what it is. But anyway, we have an assembly pipeline, and for those of you who are interested in this, I can go through it. But what we do is we assemble Illumina data and PacBio data, so we end up with completed genomes. Next slide, please. This one is boasting, a little bit boasting, but it's mostly a shock. Jerry Brand is an emeritus professor now at Texas UTEX in Austin, Texas. He is a world authority on microalgae and microalgal strain libraries, and he kindly came to visit us in KAUST and wrote back with that little phrase at the top right. We had thought that other countries in the Middle East, a little further north to us, would perhaps have a very advanced microalgal approach, but in fact what they do is use the American strain libraries. We had done the hard work. It took 3 to 4 years to build this library up, and that's 3 to 4 years of day in, day out hard work. And we now have a very, very good strain library. Now, from that library, 425, they're all interesting. We took the best ones. So we've taken the Usain Bolt types, okay? And they've been characterized very, very fully. There's been a lot of chemical and metabolomic analysis. And arising from that work, 8 of them have been licensed to industry. So this is about knowledge exchange. Vice Chancellor challenged you in a way to think about knowledge exchange. You can do it that way. You can do work in the lab and then patent and have that knowledge licensed to an industry. That's one way to do things. Next slide. And that established the base for biotechnology. Next slide, please. So the next section is looking really at what we've done with particular strain. So it's an example of what we do. And that is systems biology and synthetic biology. You need systems biology in order to understand how the strain works at a genome-wide way, because you're trying to bend the strain to your will. The next thing you need, synthetic biology, is a useful approach to manipulate a strain to make it a high producer, okay, which is the thing that we didn't quite get in the Rhodococcus project, but we will, okay, because we're going to use synthetic biology to do it. Traditional approaches required different tools which are much harder to make. Synthetic biology is a very quick technique. Next slide, please. So we were basing this on Synchococcus. These are pictures of some Synchococcus strains from our library. It's a fast-growing, in our case, marine cyanobacterium. There are some that live in fresh water, but ours live in the marine environment. They're 1 to 2 microns in length. They look like baby E. coli. In the sea, these guys are responsible for about half the biological carbon conversion in the marine environment. They're present from the poles to the equator to the pole. Okay? Where they're located is in the top layers of the sea, all right? Because they are adapted to that environment. Inside, they have got thylakoid membranes, phycobilisomes, and carboxysomes, all of which you've been introduced to. Interestingly, because they're at the top of the sea, they have a lot of ancillary photopigments. Photopigments, everybody uses chlorophyll, but they also have other pigments that are part of what's called the antenna complex, which takes photons in and feeds it to the photocenter. And by changing these ancillary photopigments, you can operate at different depths, because as the light hits the water, so light is split and you start getting red light is the only light that goes into the depths. So if you have red sensitive photo antennae, you can still operate at depth. Next slide, please. So here's the subject of today, a CCF 101. Here she or he is sitting harmlessly in a tube. Next slide, please. This work was done by Yime as part of her PhD, and she's been doing a lot of quantitative physiology. And what she's shown, rather interestingly, if you see this lower blue line, okay, that's 50 microeinsteins at 35 degrees centigrade, suggests, in low light, they don't like high temperature. But if you give them high light, they do like it. Basically, this is a strain that uses light, it uses energy, and when it's got energy, it's rich, and when it's rich, it can deal with high temperatures, it can deal with salinity and so on. It's an example of a highly robust strain. As long as it has energy, it's able to cope with a pretty broad profile. To put this into context, the model systems, or even the bespoke industrial Sinicococcus that are out there in America, the industrial one, they boast that can take 200 microeinsteins. Phew. Ours can do more. Okay? So, ours is light adapted, high temperature adapted, and its major ancillary protein is phycocyanin, blue green, which is why it's green. Next slide, please. Here she is. These are beautiful micrographs developed at KAUST by our colleagues in the imaging core lab. And you can see how nicely organized the cell is with these thylakoid membranes. These are arrays of photosynthetic antennae. Okay, the cell under high light is full of carbon storage compounds. It has that much energy, it just fills the cell up with carbon. Next slide, please. At a speciation level, it's firmly within the Sinicococcus, quite happily. That's it there. Next slide, please. And we could talk for hours on this. Here's a genome, La. It's just done. This is a full genome done. It has, let's see, it's almost 3 million base pairs. It's got almost 3,000 genes. For those into bioinformatics, we have a full tagged ID system so that each protein can be searched across numerous databases. And this organism, this genome rather, can be used to map and predict metabolic function, which is what we did with the Rhodococcus. So we can look in the cell and we can see what's in there. The difference is Rhodococcus has a genome size almost double, and it has got thousands of enzymes that are of industrial interest. Bless it, CCF101 really has quite a limited genome, and we're going to have to put genes in order for it to be a useful factory. It's really only able to make more of itself. And that's because in the marine environment, there's a lot of competition, and you do not carry DNA that you aren't going to use. So their genomes are being kept in a very small and compressed way. Next slide, please. From that genome data, you can produce this. This is a complete metabolic map, okay? And the first time you look at it, you kind of feel a bit dizzy and think, why did my supervisor do this to me? What did I, couldn't I just have a project with like 10 genes instead of 3,000? What you do is you don't look at all of it at once. You look at parts of it. Now, remember I was talking about phosphoenyl pyruvate, yeah? That early, it's the link between the Calvin cycle and the TCA, okay? Now, that is that big circle down there. Next slide, please. We'll get back to that one. Just keep thinking about PEP. In order to augment the genetic capabilities of CCF101, we need to get DNA in. Okay? Now, with the Rhodococcus project, where we had a barrier was we didn't have vectors, plasmid vectors, that could quickly go into our industrial strains. A plasmid is almost a mini, well, it is a chromosome, but it's almost an organism in its own right, and it's like trying to train a monkey to do something. Maybe the monkey wants to do it, maybe he doesn't. Sometimes they don't want to do something at all, for good reason. Some plasmids will not grow in your strain, and many of the advanced gene expression plasmids were unable to function in Rhodococcus, which was an issue for us. However, wait a couple of years, technology comes to your rescue. Synthetic biology. What that really means is people have made the chemistry of DNA synthesis so routine that you can synthesize thousands upon thousands of base pairs from a DNA list, just from a file. So you can write ATGCCC and it will just start putting them in and making picogram levels of DNA. So you can design any DNA molecule you like, right? Is it expensive? It's not that expensive. It sounds expensive when you first look at it, but for something in the region of $3,000, you can actually generate quite a large molecule, 6 kilobase molecule. That sounds a lot until you think in order to do that by cloning would take a postdoc at least a year and would cost closer to 20,000. So what you're looking at is technology making things easier to do, but also cheaper to do. What you can do with it, typically, is you can build your own piece of genetic machinery, okay? That can be whatever you want to do. You can also put new genes in. So let's say we want to take an enzyme from Rhodococcus and put it into Cyanobacterium. Yes, we can do that. We can literally design the enzyme. Before, we'd have to cut the DNA, clone it, find it, express it, you know? This way, we can just sequence it, put a promoter in front, and stick it into the cell. You can also make new promoters, new regulatory systems, and you can do something rather clever. You can optimize the codon preference by literally refactoring the gene. So you can completely change the gene sequence, maintain the protein sequence, but make the codon preference fit the organism that you're going to express it in. So it's a very useful technique. Next one, please. So in our synthetic biology, what we've done is address this first issue of moving DNA in and out of CCF101. That strain does not have any plasmids. It's a feature of marine Sinicococcus that they don't have plasmids because they really are under too much selective pressure to have a small genome. Freshwater Sinicococcus are much more less stressed, if you will, and actually can carry plasmids and have a bigger genome as well. So it's not that they can't have plasmids, it's just that environmentally it's too expensive, there are no plasmids. So this is a quick resume, and I could talk for hours on this, but I'm not going to because Aslin will kill me, but it involves circular plasmid maps, which I love dearly. It's a plan to build a completely artificial replicon. We go to the next slide. This is the replicon here, PKA1. This is a proven and validated gram-negative replication origin, working quite nicely, expressing kanamycin resistance. It is a biologically safe vector. It cannot self-conjugate anywhere. It still has some mobilization properties, but not very many. And it is a pretty basic cloning vector for cyanobacteria. Cyanobacteria does not have good cloning vectors. As a result, putting DNA in and out is a real, real pain, and it's a slow step. So we've built that to speed up how we manipulate our cyanobacteria. And if you remember, Professor Latif was talking about learning from your challenges and failures. One of our challenges in the Rhodococcus program was we didn't have a vector to do the final step, okay? So we've learned from that and we put one in. Next slide, please. So systems biology. Again, we have a genome and we're interested in the genes in the cell. We're interested in how the cell operates. We can, from the functional annotation, derive a complete metabolic map. When you look at that map, we were interested in carbon flux. If we want to make this cell into a real factory, we need to have very, very high carbon flux. So the first thing we did is we wanted to look at the TCA cycle. Now, previous publications from the Rubin group showed that another Sinicococcus, PCC7942, this is a model system, this organism surprisingly didn't have a TCA cycle. It's got a TCA alley, but it doesn't have a cycle. So where you can see the clear boxes, those genes are missing. So this was a piece of work where they looked at the genome, mapped it to the TCA, and oh my God, it's missing bits. They looked and those genes aren't there. There's some controversy. There's another strain where another group say that if you take this protein here and overexpress it, it is a little bit like a succinate dehydrogenase, but the rates at which it work are physiologically very low, and it's unlikely, frankly, to work. What you're really looking at here is the effect of having free energy. The parts of the TCA cycle that are missing in a heterotroph are usually where you recycle carbon from complex carbon molecules that you've brought into the cell and effectively eaten. In a cyanobacterium, the cell makes its own carbon, okay? It's got free energy in the daytime, and it's very efficient at doing that. It doesn't need to invest in recycling and taking in carbon. Most wild-type Sinicococcus can't take up sugar. Why would they? And make their own, you know? So, on the right-hand side was some work done on this model system. On the left-hand side is our keg-derived one, and where there's a green circle, a green box, is where we have a gene, and where there is something else, nothing, there's nothing. And what we see is an even more drastic response, that we're missing everything from oxaloacetate through to oxaglutarate. But it's okay, because they're all involved in taking in heterotrophic carbon. Next slide, please. So what we did, previous workers had looked just at the DNA level, and we're rather basic people, you know. We figured, never mind if this enzyme or that enzyme is doing it, let's look for the product. Can you see these intermediates at all in the cell? I apologize for the complete absence of you being able to read. Those of you who can have phenomenal eyesight. But basically, we measured citrate, isocitrate, oxaglutarate, succinate, and malate. These were the stable compounds that we could get into the GC system. And what we did is we did an extraction from the cell when it's growing and then looked for them. And what you see is those peak heights, citrate, isocitrate, and malate, are all 10 to the 4 or more. The peak height here, I do love computers, it will give you a peak. The software will give you a peak. That peak is 400, which is in the noise, okay? But the computer's like, oh, the man wants a peak, I'll give him a peak, 400. Basically, there's undetectable levels of succinate. Now, this is a bit of a challenge, because according to the models, the photosystems are using succinate as an acceptor. I don't think we know yet what's going on, But I have a feeling we're not using succinate in CCF 101, nor are we doing it in 7942. It suggests that our understanding of metabolism, it's rather simple. We kind of think everything has the same metabolism. No, it doesn't. It has the metabolism it needs. That's all. So we have to go look at that. But fundamentally, we've shown here with the systems approach that the TCA cycle is a TCA alley. Next slide. What that means is that PEP is the major part where we can work to increase carbon flux into the rest of the cell. So that's given us a target of PEP. So that is the end of that section. Next section, please. Next slide. Spin-outs. Universities are where you go to learn, to study, scholarship, research, and innovation. And this is never more true than for new universities growing in new countries, growing in the fastest growing and most important part of the world, Asia. It's all over for us in Europe. We're old and tired. We're not going to be much more than an interesting place to visit, I suspect. Asia is where it's going to happen. And what was going to make it happen is if you guys start to innovate as well as research, just as the Vice Chancellor has challenged you. Some of you in your work are going to have an idea. Instead of being scared of it, you need to talk to some people. I'm sure the university's got people to advise you. Discuss it and see whether that idea could make something. Remember Facebook, the chappy who runs Facebook. What is it, Zuckerman? Zuckerman. Zuckerman, when he presented his idea for Facebook, it's famous for being the worst pitch for an idea ever, because Zuckerman just was shy and didn't really want to talk. The point was, his idea was absolutely brilliant, and the money guys saw it. He then had to make it work, and that was hard. It's not easy to make a spin out. With a spin out, there's no shortcut. Everything is hard work. My father said, business is like a wheelbarrow. You have to pick it up with both hands and push. It's just got one wheel, right? It's like that. But you have a tremendous benefit of seeing your science going into an idea that's making a contribution to the society that supported you in the first place. And that is why we do it. We don't do it to become $1 million. What would we do with the money? You know, we have no clue. We do it to see our science make a difference. To see, for instance, green chemistry make some really important advances so that our kids, our grandkids can live in a better world that isn't going to be ruined by climate change. So there's your challenge, all right? The spin-outs that we've done here is the first, next slide, the first spin-out in Saudi Arabia from KAUST in biotechnology. It's the largest spin-out from KAUST by a country mile. We closed our Series A funding at $4 million. And that was an interesting learning experience. The company is engaged in making specialist chemicals. The chemicals cost $10,000 a kilo, and we've already made a couple of thousand dollars worth of the material just in pilot tests. So these are used for personal skincare. The biggest market for personal skincare is, can anyone guess? Aslin is not allowed to guess because she was part of the business plan. Asia. Okay? Asia is where skincare products are being sold, bought more than anywhere else. It's where the natural products are being used. And if you look on the adverts, you see them. This is a material which feeds into a business-to-business model. And that's the sort of thing you should think about in your route. Going all the way to the customer's hard work, but a B2B works. So this is an example of what you can do, okay? It's top quality science. The difference really between a scientific paper and a spin-out, we don't have the word could or may or in future, could be, maybe. We say, it does this, it does it at this level, and it makes that much per gram, per day, per meter squared. It's all engineering and maths. And because we can prove that data, that's where we raise the money. Because these people, if you're is anyone massively rich here? I thought not. But if you are massively rich, your problem is the money is going away by inflation day by day. You've got to do something with it. So you invest it. So these guys are very hard-headed. They're not giving you money as charity. They want money back. All right? What we want to do is we want to see our technology in operation. They want their money. We want the technology. It's how it works. But the difference is you have to be very clear about what you've got. So Aslin and Jaja, who are two founders, it's me, Aslin, Jaja, and a colleague, Duncan. There's four of us, and that's all you need to make the company. You don't need hundreds. You need some really good people. And I'm very grateful to Unisel for training up all the people I stole, Vice Chancellor. They're excellent people to steal. One day we let you have them back. Next slide, please. So quick conclusion. We've been working on non-model industrial systems. We've got a huge benefit from a collaboration with Unisel. The Unisel collaboration is one of the longest I've been running. And as I said, it's had the beauty of running even when there was no funding. We continued. And we did that because it was interesting, it was good science, and these are my friends. So I want to work with my friends. We've developed in Cambridge probably the largest industrial bacterial program for Malaysia. They all belong to Malaysia. There's none of this cultural imperialism with me. This stuff is, it's back here in Unisel. And we've done the same in the Red Sea, so we have big industrial libraries. We are very good at selecting lead organisms, and I think you can see the pattern, the way we work. And then we use genomics to rapidly advance understanding. We're now using synthetic DNA technology, which is the new step that we didn't have before. And we've established an industrial spin-out, and we would love to establish one here from the Unisel work we've got in Rhodococcus and others coming on. Next slide, please. None of this, zero, zip, nothing would be done by John Archer. John Archer is this old fellow here. What you need is a brilliant team of young, dedicated scientists, led by Aslin. She's a research scientist in Kaos. That is the same rank. It's somewhere between very senior assistant and associate professor. Jaja Suhaiza, research technician grade 2. It's like the army, you have stripes. Okay? Jaja, there's Yime, there's Nisa, there's Muataz, Stefan, and previous members, Magbuba, Fred Kinua, James Brown, Patricio, Flavio. Mexicans have very long names and don't use any of them. He has five other names, none of them is Flavio, but his name is Flavio. And then Joanna at the end. Joanna she's British. She has the distinction of being a subaqua diver. And in Saudi, they banned subaqua. Then they had a licensing system. And she went and got her license as a licensed diver trainer because the kingdom, with all of its little idiosyncrasies, never had a stipulation that women couldn't be training divers. So that's another example of how Kaos move things. This is the team that helped me, particularly the top four have been engaged on the cyanobacterial project, the top left two engaged on Rhodococcus project. Next slide, please. At an organizational level, science is collaborative. You can't do it on your own. And here are the collaborations we have. For our chemical and oil field work, we have SABIC and Saudi Aramco. And then on the genome scale modeling, Unisel, Cambridge, of course, when I was there, UPM. UPM seems to have, no, who's the second one? UKM. And then Genome Malaysia, who've been phenomenal supportive. Prof. Noor has really helped move us through this and continues to do so. Then we have Chalmers University looking at some informatics. Really good friends in Texas. Not all Americans voted for Trump. In fact, more didn't. Okay, remember this. It's very difficult for a lot of decent people in America right now. And if you can think of a prayer, pray for what you want, you know. But anyway, Texas are terribly nice. And that's David Nobles and Jerry Brand and Joanna. Yes, Joanna, who is a Texas lady with boots and everything and a tremendous algal biotechnologist. Synthetic metabolic engineering, we have a close partnership with Peter Lindblad's lab in Uppsala University. Next slide, please. So, we come to the end. It's not really the end, it's just a little full stop for a bit because we're going into the lab in the afternoon and going sampling tomorrow. But for the moment, Fermikase, Shukran, Zizia, I can't do that one, and thank you. Questions? Next slide. See. That's the view of the Red Sea.
Thank you to the Honorable Professor Dr. John Archer for the stimulating discussion. We hope everyone found it beneficial and valuable. Ladies and gentlemen, with the great respect, I would like to invite Yang Berbahagia Professor Emeritus Next, I would like to invite Professor Dr. Muhammad Nur bin Awawi to give a token appreciation to the Honorable Dr. John Archer. Please welcome. I would like to invite Professor Emeritus Dr. Abdul Latif Ibrahim to give a token appreciation to Yang Berbahagia Professor Dr. Muhammad Nur bin Awawi.